What prophets? He said, would God, how I desire, how I pray, how I wish that all of God's people were prophets, and that the Lord will put a spirit upon them all. That's the same thing, universal promise of God, the outpouring of the Holy Ghost, and the empowering by the Holy Ghost, the energizing by the Holy Ghost, that will happen to everybody. He says, I wish that all of God's people will become prophets. Who are prophets? The people that receive revelation from God, and they give that revelation back to the people, and they reveal the mind of God, the word of God. He said, I wish all of God's people were preachers, were prophets, were pastors, and then the Lord will pour his spirit upon them, and they'll declare the word of God without favor, without fear, in the power of the Holy Ghost. The day has come. The time has come. And the Lord will do it for you, for me, for us together in Jesus' name. We're looking at Isaiah chapter 44, Isaiah chapter 44, this universal promise of the outpouring of the Holy Ghost upon you, upon me, upon every one of us. And the Lord says, everyone that is thirsty, everyone that is desiring, everyone that is asking, I'm going to pour out my spirit upon them. Isaiah chapter 44 verse 3. For I will pour water upon him that is thirsty. Any thirsty person here today? Praise the Lord, you'll get it. And floods upon the dry ground. I will pour my spirit upon thy seed, and my blessing upon thy offspring. It's coming. In chapter 59 of Isaiah chapter 59, we're reading from verse 21. Isaiah chapter 59, verse 21, as for me, this is my covenant with them, says the Lord, my spirit which is upon thee, and my words which I have put in thy mouth, shall not depart out of thy mouth, nor out of the mouth of thy seed, nor out of the mouth of thy seed, saith the Lord, from henceforth and forever. When the Holy Ghost comes, how long will he stay with us? Forever. Tell me again.
Forever.
Tell me once again.
Forever.
What you are getting today, you are never going to lose.
Amen.
Will increase and flow and overflow in your life, in your ministry, in Jesus' name. And when the time comes, the time of challenge and the time of ministry, to be able to get that word out to the people in the power of the Holy Ghost, that Holy Ghost will manifest himself in your ministry and life at that situation, that time, in Jesus' name. We're looking at Matthew now, chapter 3. Matthew chapter 3. And then, now we're told the title or the name of this seed that the Lord is going to put upon you and going to put upon us all. Everybody say, all. And say, I am part of that all. God bless you, you'll be part of that. In Matthew chapter 3, Matthew chapter 3, I'm reading from verse 8. Matthew chapter 3, we're reading from verse 8. It says, bring forth therefore fruits meet for repentance, and think not to say within yourselves, we have Abraham to our father. For I say unto you, that God is able of these stones to raise up children unto Abraham. Again, can you look up for a moment? I'm saying that, you know, these prophets, you know, some things they say, the people there, they'll be saying, how possible is this? How can this be? I'm believing that even if you go to ask the people, you go to ask John the Baptist, can you explain this to me that you said that God is able to raise up stones to become children unto Abraham? And John might say, well, I remember I said that, to raise up stones and then make them children unto Abraham. Well, I know that God is able to do all things. Maybe that's where they'll stop. But we know that God said he'll take the stony heart out of, those are the stones, the people that hear the word of God, and it's like water that, you know, gets on the stone, never gets inside. And the people that hear the word of God, and it has no impact on them and no result on them, and it's like you just pour water on the stone and you knock it, you put fire even under it, and the fire will not affect the stone, and the knocking will not affect the stone, and no instruction will affect the stone. And then God says, I'm going to make those stony hearts, I'm going to make them my children, and I'm going to take the stony heart out of them and give them hearts of flesh, and they will be mine. And when I do that, I'll pour my spirit upon them, And because there are no more stony hands, but children of faith, by like Abraham, they receive the Spirit just like you're going to receive this morning. And then the Spirit will come upon you, the stony heart is gone, and God has raised up stones to become children unto Abraham. And then it goes on to say also in verse 10, now the axe is laid unto the root of the trees. Therefore, every tree which bringeth not forth good fruit is hewn down, is cut down, and cast into the fire. Now comes your promise. I said, now comes your promise. It says, I indeed baptize you with water unto repentance, but he that cometh after me is mightier than I, whose shoes I am not worthy to bear. He shall baptize me with the Holy Ghost and with fire. You know, when we have this Holy Ghost, what I said is, you know, there are people that, you know, speaking in terms of the initial evidence, not the final evidence. It's the initial evidence. There's a continuing evidence, the fire, the fervency. Look at Elijah. It's not just the literal fire that came, but look at his spirit, a fiery, fervent man. And when they pray, when such people pray, you can see the fervency, you can see the fire. When such people preach, you can see the fire, you can see the fervency. When such people stand on a particular subject, you can see the fire, you can see the fervency. That's what they say when they stand before the enemy and they declare the truth before their persecutors. You can see the fire, you can see the fervency. That continuing evidence of the presence and the power and the prominence of the Holy Ghost in a person's life is more than, you know, these Pentecostal churches that just come together and all they do is, you know, speak in tongues. And it's a repetition of what they have spoken for about 10 years. They say once, you know, they feel like they want to speak in tongues again, they just bring it out again. It's like something I put in the bucket and they bring it out. And then when temptation comes, there's no fire, there's no fervency. When understanding of the Bible is needed, there's no understanding of the Bible. And when you need to explain, ask a question in the Bible, there's no proper answer to that. They don't know. It's only speaking in tongues. That's only the initial evidence. But the fire of the Holy Ghost and the power of the Holy Ghost coming upon us, that is what we need. And thank God it has come.
Amen.
I said it has come. You know, those of us who wear shoes. Now, if you wear shoes, this shoe that you lace, that's, it says, whose shoes I'm not, you know, able to even put the lace on. Then that string there. Now, if there's something there, just underneath that string, we'll call it tongue. That's the tongue of that shoe. You understand? What if, you know, somebody has only the tongue of the shoe and it doesn't have the shoe itself? And it's only carrying, you know, he puts the, you know, the tongue on the something there and he's just walking barefoot and say, what's that? It's the tongue of my shoe, because the tongue of my shoe is the most important. And then I just put you there. I say, but you're not wearing shoes. I said, never mind, the tongue is there. The Holy Ghost is what you need. The power of the Holy Ghost is what we need. And the fire and the fervency and the inspiration, illumination, enlightenment in the knowledge of the Word of God that we never knew before. And then when we look at that word, it comes afresh with power and with pungency unto us. And then we declare it without fear, without favor. And the people, they are asking, what shall we do to be saved? That evidence of making the people get under conviction and calling upon the Lord as they hear the Word of God, that is the greatest evidence of the Holy Ghost in our lives. And we're all going to have that in Jesus' name. It says, I did baptize you with water unto repentance, but he that cometh after me is mightier than I, whose shoes I'm not worthy to bear. He shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire. Let's look now at John chapter 14. John chapter 14, as the promise is, you know, being expanded and explained and expounded unto us. We're looking at John chapter 14, and we're reading from verses 16 and 17. It says, and I will pray the Father, and he shall give you another comforter. that she may abide with you. How long? Tell me out loud. Have you ever seen some, you know, tongue-talking people? I'm filled with the Holy Ghost, I'm filled with the Holy Ghost. And then when something happens, they don't have anybody to encourage them. And there's no voice on the inside that is encouraging them. And when they get into sorrow, into some traumatic situations, there is nobody to comfort them. And there is no comfort from within. And then there are the people that are, you know, that can go to church today. I don't think I can even read the Bible because, you know, this happened and this happened and this happened. And there's no comfort for them. And the Holy Ghost that they say is living inside them never says a word, never comforts them, and never tells them, get up. This is the reason this has happened. You don't need to lose your conviction or your consecration. You don't need to lose your life. Think about people that say they have the Holy Ghost and they're committing suicide because a problem does this happen and I didn't see any pastor, I didn't see any comforter, I didn't see any help, and they still speaking in tongues. And the more they speak in tongues, the more they have all these nightmares and all these things, and I'm filled with the Holy Ghost. When the Holy Ghost comes, he is a comforter. And he says in that verse 16, and he says, I will pray the Father, and he shall give you who? Another comforter, that ye may abide with you forever. No wonder Paul and Silas began to sing the praises of the Lord in the prison. When their feet, when the stocks, they had the Holy Ghost. And the Holy Ghost was comforting them. When we have the Holy Ghost, yes, the initial evidence, I'll tell you again, the initial evidence is speaking in tongues, but the comfort of the Lord in your life. And the comfort of the Holy Ghost in everything that you are passing through. This is happening and the Lord is explaining to you that's why that is happening. And that other thing is happening. What will bring confusion normally? What will bring depression normally? Then the Holy Ghost comforts you and he says, this is the reason for that. And then you are still able to go on. You are going to have that comforter. Another comforter, that she may abide with you. How long? Even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it seeth him not, neither knoweth him. But ye know him, for he dwelleth with you, and shall be where? In you. He shall be in you. That means that when you are in the Congress, is there. When you are not in the Congress, you are back at home, is there. When your wife is, you know, trying to, you know, say this and that, the Holy Ghost is there, nearer to you than all your enemies. And because of that, you know, the fire is there, the comfort is there, the hope is there, the expectation is there, the faith is there, the word is there, the scriptures are there, the truth is there. What else do you need? We need the Holy Ghost. I said we need the Holy Ghost. He's telling us in chapter 16, I'm reading from verse 7. And we're looking in at chapter 16, verse 7. Nevertheless, I tell you the truth. It is expedient, it is profitable for you that I go away. For if I go not away, the Comforter will not come unto you. But if I depart, I will send, tell me the next thing, him, not it. There are some people that think that the Holy Ghost is like, you know, the air. It's like the force. It's like, you know, whatever it is. That it doesn't have personality. Of course, it has personality. Because the Father, the Son, and then the Holy Spirit, as the Father has personality, he has personality. As the Son has personality, he has personality too. He said, I will send him unto you. And when he is come, he will reprove the world of sin. He will reprove the world of sin. You know what he's telling us? When you have the Holy Ghost, if you see sin anywhere, in anyone, in the church, outside the church, you will reprove that sin. It's not you. It's the Holy Ghost within. They say, I don't understand. Brother so-and-so, pastor so-and-so, anything, anytime he sees anything that is sinful, defiling, anything that is corrupting, he cannot keep quiet. I don't know. Even when, you know, you are telling him, say, okay, that's right. I hear you. Immediately, when you finish, then there's something that rises up within him. It's the Holy Ghost. Many people don't understand, and they think that the people that never talk against sin, never reproach sin, and the people they can see, you know, stealing going on right there in front of them, they can see immorality going on there, adultery going on there in front of them, and there's no fire within. Everything is just cool and calm, and they're saying, well, people are people. People will do what they want to. Let's move on. Forget about all that. That's not the Holy Ghost. If those people turn around and then they begin to speak it, I say, hey, that's false. The evidence that the Holy Ghost is within you is that if he sees sin, he will reprove the world of sin. And a preacher, a pastor, a minister, a leader that has the Holy Ghost dwelling within him, it will not just be in a church and you have worldliness there, sin there, evil there, corruption there, you know, kind of pregnancy there, abortion there. I mean, pregnancy with those teenage girls, and we'll just, you know, just having a crouch there and it just saying, well, we love everybody. Well, I hope you'll, you know, settle all these problems and all these challenges. That, you know, if you think about your future, this pregnancy may hinder your education. It will not say this pregnancy may, you know, hinder your eternal life and hinder your heaven, may hinder your education, but you know, take care of yourself. And mother, don't, you know, it has happened. Just keep cool. And, you know, just have the grace of God to manage everything. That's the Holy Ghost. When the Holy Ghost comes, he puts a fire within you. That you will not tolerate sin. You will not encourage sin. Now that you're going to gloss over sin. That's the presence of the Holy Ghost. All these churches, I don't understand them. They have the Holy Ghost. And you see a lot of things there. You know, so somebody came to tell me and said that they went to a particular place. You have all these hundreds of thousands of people. And as they, you know, they were there and they shouted, Holy Ghost, and everyone, they were coming out. You know, somebody, you know, just put light on a cigarette and started to smoke. And then they went to ask somebody, they said, ah, look at this, that the Holy Ghost is on all of us. That's what they said. And the volume was speaking in tongues everywhere. And then I saw somebody immediately we came up. He just put something. Yes, you know, that's what God said. That he will pour his spirit upon all flesh, upon smoking flesh, upon drinking flesh, upon adulterous flesh, upon fornicating flesh, upon stealing flesh, upon all flesh. Do you believe that? There's repentance before that Holy Ghost will come. There's righteousness before that Holy Ghost will come. We need to understand so that we're not deceived. I pray you'll not be deceived. Come back to John chapter 16. I'm reading there in verse 8. And when he's come, he will reprove the world of sin and of righteousness and of judgment. Of sin, because they believe not in me. Of righteousness, because I go to my Father and you see me no more. Of judgment, because the prince of this world is judged already. I have yet many things to say unto you, but ye cannot bear them now. How be it when he, the Spirit of, tell me, you know, the kind of false doctrine, error, you find among these tongue talking people, Holy Ghost, Holy Ghost, Holy Ghost, the error, the false doctrine, the mutilating of scripture, and the corruption of scripture that you find in the midst of such people, terrible. That means then that is not the real thing. When the real thing, the Holy Ghost, when it comes, what it says, when that Holy Ghost comes in his power, when that Holy Ghost comes in his illumination, when that Holy Ghost comes in his revelation, it says what he's going to do is the Spirit of truth to start with. He will guide you into what? Into all truth. Gather all the Pentecostal churches in this land together and ask them the same question. How does a person get saved? This Pentecostal church will tell you one thing. This will tell you another thing. This will tell you another thing. This will tell you another thing. By the time you finish, you are confused. Get all the Pentecostal churches together and ask them, is there sanctification? Okay, if there's sanctification,